Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to our second panel. My name is Antonie Nord, and I'm the head of the Middle East and North Africa department here at the Heinrich-Böll Foundation. Dear guests, we have heard a lot about the atrocities committed in Syrian detention centers and prisons. As the participants of our first panel reported, Syrian and international human rights activists, journalists, and lawyers have been collecting evidence of mass murder, torture, rape, and gross ill-treatment in government custody in Syria. Without the courage and commitment of survivors, it would be much more difficult to document these massive human rights violations while the regime is still in power and the system of killing and torturing of thousands of people is still in place. First-hand experience of witnesses is not only important for the future prosecution of the perpetrators. The voices of former detainees, listening to their stories and their political vision, is also a powerful instrument against the propaganda of the Assad regime. A regime that claims that all detainees are terrorists and denies reports on human rights violations. Most of us can only assume how difficult it must be to share a personal story of torture and survival. I can only applaud Khaled Rawas for his courage to talk about his experiences and the experiences of others in Syrian prisons. And I'm very happy that Anwar al Bounni will talk about his important work that aims at providing legal support for victims and witnesses of serious violations of human rights. I am sure that this will send a strong message of hope to other survivors, and at the same time, a message to those responsible for these horrific crimes that the world is watching and that they will be brought to justice, as Lotte Leicht said in the previous panel, sooner or later. I will now introduce our first speaker to you, Anwar al Bounni. Anwar is a prominent Syrian human rights lawyer. He was involved in defending people who were prosecuted for expressing their opinions in non-violent ways, including the so-called Damascus Spring activists. In 2006, al Bounni and a number of other human rights activists were arrested for having signed a petition calling for the improvement of the relationship between Syria and Lebanon. After a trial that was considered to be in breach of international standards, he was sentenced to 5 years in prison in April 2007. After his release from prison in 2011, he continued to defend detainees. He had to escape from Syria at the end of 2014 and is now working in Germany. Anwar, the floor is yours.
Good evening, everybody. Thank you for being here, first of all. Your support and your presence has a huge influence on our hopes. I'd like to thank the ICCHR for the support and sharing in our enormous work with all its members and collaborators. And I'd like to thank the Heinrich-Böll-Stiftung as well for standing at our sides, for continuing this work. I would expect that you've already listened to a lot of details about the crimes that are committed in Syria. The Syrians know about it, and they assume that all the world knows about it. And my dear colleagues Lotte and Chris have talked about it, and also the former detainee Khaled is going to speak about the daily suffering of detainees in detention centers. I would like, therefore, to focus on a slightly different aspect. I think that all of those hearing about this event might ask the question, why do you take this way? Why do you do that now? Why are you undertaking this endeavor now? Why here in Germany? What are the messages that you would like to send out by undertaking this work? Why? What's the goal? What's the objective of this work, not only on an internal Syrian level? Why is it so important on a general level? I think, why are we taking this where I would say that the world as a whole for the last 6 years up to now has been observing and knows about the size of the crimes which are committed in Syria. And still, nothing stirs. International reports, I'm not only talking about reports by human rights organizations, I'm talking about UN reports, committees set up by the Security Council to investigate crimes of the use of chemical weapons and crimes against humanity and human rights, coming up with a huge amount of evidence that enormous crimes against humanity, of genocide, of forced expulsion are committed in Syria, and these reports are published in the open. And the way to justice is still blocked by an international decision for the Syrians. We, with the help of our friends, particularly in Germany, in Europe, in France, in Spain, with their legal aid and with the help of the European legislation, we could at least open a breach in this concrete wall that is set between us and justice. What is happening now in Germany is a proof that this breach is widening and is going to encompass much broader space. Why now? Now, besides that we have seen this huge amount of time passing by without anyone steering and without justice being realized, we think that we now have to investigate this process and this possibility. Plus, the refugees that have arrived in great numbers in Europe have helped us enormously in finding the victims and also the ones responsible for these crimes. And in the last year, particularly, we saw the huge wave of refugees arriving in Europe, forced to leave their homes by the Syrian regime, and that helped us to find victims and evidence and witnesses for these crimes. Why in Berlin? Why in Germany? Fortunately, it is the case that the German laws and legislations provide the possibility, and the international judicial authority, and I think it's the only jurisdiction in Europe, and I think in this respect Germany is exceptional, that its internal laws and legislations have granted a space to prosecute international crimes, that is, prosecuting crimes against humanity. And that's why, with the help of our friends in the ECCHR, we find the legal possibility that enables us to prosecute this issue. And in particular, it's very important in Germany, since what we've seen in France and Spain, where they were relying on Syrian nationals holding double nationalities, and even when they were prosecuted, the justice for Syrians had a simple sight. They were only prosecuted because they had also hold French nationality. But the work here in Germany is so important because it asks for justice for Syrians because they're Syrians, because they're Syrian victims, not because they hold another passport.
This is why the claim and the complaint in Germany is of great importance. So why specifically this case? I believe there are a number of cases in Europe against ISIS, against the Nusra Front, against factions of the Syrian army and other factions. They were referred to the court and they're prosecuted for the crimes they have committed. Why is this one of particular importance? It reestablishes the balance of the concept of justice known to the world. Justice has been selective in achieving, the world has been selective in achieving justice. It only applied justice when it was in their interests. We're trying with this complaint to reestablish the balance, to regain the value to the concept of justice. Justice needs to be applied because it's a must, not only because it is in line with the interests of certain countries. This is specifically what we would like to prove with this complaint. We would also like to prompt everybody to believe that justice cannot be selective. Justice in general is a concept for peace. It's a concept to reduce congestion. It's a concept to combat radicalism. When justice becomes selective, then it is counterproductive. Selective justice destroys peace. It destroys the belief in the idea of justice. It fuels retaliatory steps. Against this background, reestablishing this balance is of paramount importance for Syria. We're not seeking revenge. We're seeking to pave the way for a bright Syrian future. We need to reestablish peace in Syria. The message is that retaliation, taking revenge, is not the correct path for victims. There is a different path, and that's the path of justice. What is the aim of our work? In reality, I believe and I hope that our work does not only aim to achieve justice for Syrians. I'm full of hope that it's not restricted to Syrians. I think if every criminal knows that he would be held accountable, we would save many, many lives. If there are effective international measures against criminals, if he had, for instance, effective measures against al-Bashir in Sudan, although there are international arrest warrants from the ICC, if we had that, if impunity is guaranteed, Bashar al-Assad would not have had the courage to do what he's doing. If we had measures against all criminals, whether in Iran, in Russia, in Syria, if we had measures in place, it would have a deterring factor, a deterring effect. Justice aims to deter criminals from further action. It's not only to grant victims their rights, it's also to deter criminals from committing such crimes in the future. Now, from that perspective, the international paradigm of justice failed to do so. And this failure led al-Baghdadi, al-Saleh Muslim, and other criminals at the international levels, al-Louch and others, all these criminals would not have been able to perpetrate those crimes. Regrettably, everybody believes that they would be able to escape from justice. And this is why they continue to commit their crimes, being fully comfortable in what they're doing. Unfortunately, the international community anchored this idea. Since 2011, the international community has been speaking about a political solution, political solution, political solution. We have never talked about justice. The international community has ignored this message. This was a message to the criminals. Go ahead and kill everybody. Torture people. Glorify your crimes. At the end, there is a political solution, and all these crimes would not be brought. We'd not be persecuted. This message encouraged Bashar to commit the most horrific of crimes. These are the crimes that encouraged Muslim and al-Baghdadi and all these other criminals to commit whatever they wanted to do. They all thought, whatever, we're going to commit whatever we want, and at the end, we'll have a political solution, and we will not be persecuted. Unfortunately, this is the message that the international community is sending. Demostura is manipulating this kind of concept. His hands are full of blood. How can a war criminal make peace? I don't believe the statement. This principle is unbelievable. It's inconceivable. How can the world believe that war crimes, war criminals can make peace? Can you actually shake hands with a war criminal to make peace? Was it possible to forgive Mussolini? Why did you prosecute your criminals, your war criminals? You could have just made peace with them and saved yourself 60 million victims in the Second World War. So now we're repeating the same mistakes. The Syrian people is paying the price for these repeated mistakes. We would like to send a different message, namely that justice will come. No political solutions will protect them in future. They will be held accountable, and they will not be protected by international law, by the legitimacy of a government, by the legitimacy of political solution, or anything else. It is inconceivable that criminals would hold other criminals accountable. We, the Syrian people, will not forgive them. That is our message. It's a message of hope. A hope for the victims, a hope for the Syrian people. The path to justice has started. We're not dreaming of it anymore. We're making justice with our bare hands. Justice was not granted to us. It wasn't given to us as a gift from a generous person. No, we are making justice. And the message, ladies and gentlemen, and I think if the message comes from Germany, it is even more important. It comes at a time where the international mechanisms for justice has failed. It has lost all confidence, all trust. The international mechanism of justice has lost all credibility. I think it is of paramount importance for us in Germany to send a message to revitalize the principle of international justice. This is important. We need to commit to international justice. Organizations, entities have worked for decades to establish a concept of international justice represented or epitomized by the ICJ, the ICC, etc. We've worked so hard on that. All this work could fall apart. It has already fallen apart. So many people around the world have lost their trust in this international mechanism of justice. This is why it is important to send this message here from Germany. It is a country that is committed to the concept of international justice and the values of the international humanitarian law. And I wish that Europe, and I believe European societies still believe in the concept of international justice, still believe in human justice. I hope European countries would support this message and send a strong message saying that Europe is standing by Germany. Europe is committed to the concept of international justice that we started or that we launched here in Germany. European countries should raise their voices in demanding to anchor the concept of international justice. Please forgive me for taking too long of your time, and I wish you a fruitful discussion.
Thank you for this very and clear message. I think it became very clear that justice is also a way to let Syrians know that they are not forgotten and that their lives do matter. Thank you very much for this. Khaled, I would now like to continue with you and your testimony.
Thank you. Yeah, thank you. Also, imagine yourself standing in a 6-square-meter room with more than 30 other detainees, and one of them lay his head on your shoulder for a whole day, and when they took him out, you realized that he was dead. Imagine yourself a woman who forced to be naked in front of a man for inspection, and he sexually harassed you by touching your breast, and you can't say anything. Imagine yourself forced to rape your friend, and after you finished, they forced your friend to rape you back. Imagine yourself a woman, and they hanged you from your legs, and electricity connected to your sensitive area in front of other 15 men. Imagine your 2-year-old boy has been arrested with you, and when they took you to the investigation, they gave him a belt to hit other detainees in the hall. Imagine yourself hanged from your hands and someone put a candle under you, waiting you to be cooked very slowly until you die. Imagine that someone cut you from your back and put a metal sheet in it, and they attached the electricity to the metal sheet. Imagine yourself being tortured until your hand turned to be black and you can't sleep, not only because of pain, but because of smell of your hand. Imagine yourself just sitting and forced to see all of the previous violations and hear all the detainees' screams without being able to change anything. Imagine yourself to be afraid of talking about all of these violations after getting out of prison or even after getting out from Syria because of your deep belief that they are going to do worse things to your family. Those stories happened with the real people. Some of them died under torture, and some of them survived to spread the word. My name is Khaled Rawas, and I came from one of the oldest cities in the world, Damascus, which turned to be a huge prison. Damascus contains 17 intelligence agencies, and unfortunately, I've been in 2 of them. Now I'm gonna tell you some numbers. 13,000 detainees were executed inside Naya prison, according to Amnesty International report, which published at the 7th of February 2017. More than 10,000 detainees died under torture in 215 intelligence agency, according to photos that smuggled by a military defector codenamed Caesar. And those photos have been conferred from a Human Rights Watch organization and many other organizations. The Syrian Network for Human Rights has documented the arrest and detention for more than 117,000 people in Syria since March 2011. So in jail, we were numbers. And I feel that we are numbers now in front of the international community. And those people are not numbers. They are people. Those violations happened and still happening. And I'm pretty sure that there's someone in this very moment who's been tortured and he lost his hope to survive. And we are fighting exactly for those people. When I moved to Germany, I asked myself, what can we do to save other detainees in Syria? And when I saw what Mr. Anwar al Bounni on his Facebook page, page wrote about this court, I was shocked, actually, that as a refugee, I can prosecute in a court, in a German court, against criminals in Syria. And what we really need today is not emotions. What we really need is actions. And this one, it was the right action to do now. I belong to the revolution that believe in justice. And I can guarantee that after 6 years of what's happening in Syria, a lot of Syrians lost their faith on justice and civil work. So I think it's our job to give them hope to be faithful again by prosecuting to the court. And here, allow me to thank ECCHR organization, and especially Mr. Wolfgang and Mr. Patrick, Mrs. Annapel, Mr. Anwar, and all the people who are working in this case and organizing this event. At the end, we are not seeking for revenge, we are seeking of justice. And it's not just about saving the detainees in Syria, it's about saving humanity inside each one of us. Thank you.
Thank you very much for this very moving testimony. Thank you. I think we all need some time to let this sink in. I will only ask a couple of questions to you, one, two questions, if you're willing to answer them. Anwar, being a witness in a war crime trial can be very risky. In Syria, the people who collect evidence risk everything. Do the witnesses feel safe in Germany, you are working with?
I think that the witness in Germany is safe for himself or herself. But if there's a witness or victim that still has relatives in Syria, his family, maybe sons and daughters or relatives in Syria, we all know how much crimes are carried out by the regime against all the relatives, not now only, but even when I was detained back then, I was not only put in prison for 5 years, but also my wife was taken off her work and was dismissed. And that's only because the regime takes revenge on everything. It works on the principle of terrorizing people. Nobody is safe from this regime. And I don't think that anyone is there who wants this regime to stay in place. I think that everyone is still living now under the impression of this terror and only functions because they're fearing the regime so much. And I think that's why that a witness and the victim in Germany, of course, is safe, but what is not safe, it cannot be sure that even his or her friends, if they're still in the regime, in the areas under regime control, can be safe. That's why we have numerous witnesses in this case, but a great number of them prefer to stay anonymous because they're not afraid for themselves, but they're afraid for their relatives and for their friends and family who have stayed in Syria.
You also said that justice is a precondition for successful peace negotiations. Can you elaborate on this a little bit? What kind of justice, what kind of preconditions do you need so that the peace process or a peace process will be finally successful?
As Khaled said, I personally, and I think my family who have lived for 45 years in the prisons of the Assad regime, the father and the son, I think it's not about revenge. I don't want to take revenge on any of these people. It's about re-establishing and rebuilding Syria. I personally, I'm convinced and I deeply believe and I know that if we want to take revenge on all the crimes committed in Syria, we might find 500,000 people would be accused. Our objective with the justice in Syria and the justice for Syria is not only that we prosecute criminals. There are many, many Syrians who have committed crimes, not because they wanted to do so, not because they decided to do so, because they were put in a situation where they were forced to commit crimes. They were asked and ordered to commit crimes, and they could not refuse to execute these orders, be it in the areas of the regime or in the opposition areas or by ISIS or in the Nusra Front. I'm a Syrian, and I know that there is no Syrian in Syria, be it a Muslim or a Christian or anyone else. I'm from the city of Hama, by the way, who wants to establish an Islamic caliphate or wants to establish the rule of Sharia law. What happened in Syria is the result of the silencing and the passing over crimes of an international situation that has allowed many perpetrators to leave Syria and to also go to Syria and to take benefit from the situation and to finance the warring parties there. We know about the size and the enormous size of the crimes committed in Syria. We want the justice for these crimes to build civil peace within society. And we know that those who started the war were the ones who took the first decision, and they wanted to commit that. We don't want him to take part in the creation of the future for Syria, because Syria cannot be rebuilt without this justice being achieved. So it is important to have these justice procedures be undertaken. And if I'm not taking over from anyone else, I don't want to say that the justice system should punish everyone, but I think what is important, that justice should be granted to all. It should be open to all. That's the principle. The justice should be open and accessible to all. And maybe most Syrians would say, okay, I just want to go back home and I don't want to go into a war for taking revenge. And I think many, many Syrians are going to do just that. But it's not possible that I tell them, go back, and there's not going to be justice. Justice, the way to justice has to be accessible, it has to be open. And the Syrians are the ones who are going to take decision if they're going to go down that path or not. And then we can prevent any actions of revenge and taking the law into your own hands, because justice is there. It's the idea of giving the right kind of justice to Syrians. It's not about taking revenge. I'm not a prosecutor in the court, and I don't want to be that. But the important thing is that we need to find the path to justice. And the Syrians itself can decide if they go down that path or not.
Khaled, and what helps other Syrians who survive the ordeal of a Syrian detention center after your release?
I'm sorry, can you say that again?
How? What helped you, or what would be helpful for other Syrians who survived a Syrian detention center?
So, it's a really like this question. Like, I can't say all like representing all the other detainees, but like. The only thing that's maybe we can like that can cure us was continue fighting this regime, and when I'm saying fighting, of course not fighting with weapons, fighting this is a fight what we are doing now, so it's really when we are doing something when we like. Make anything, even if it's really small, to the detainees or to other detainees or to like even if you are delivering a food basket, it's like really you feel like you are curing yourself. Yeah.
Thank you very much. Do you want to make a last statement for this panel? Final.
Sorry.
In fact, I want to say, and I only want to say, that that justice is the grounds for property. So without justice, there's no possibility to expect the possibility for any state to exist. Our problem in Syria is, and the situation is, that the Assad regime built its power on a very simple principle, which is that it is immune to any kind of punishment in the Syrian laws and legislations. Since Hafez al-Assad took power, it issued laws to protect itself and its supporters. The Syrian constitution protects it from any kind, the Syrian president from any kind of prosecution. And the accountability in front of any justice, even only for the case of high treason. That's the only thing which he can be prosecuted. And it also protects the ministers and the law for the establishment of security, of the security tribunal, can only be prosecute someone, can only be prosecute any official of the state if the president of the courts agrees to that. So we cannot go directly to this court and prosecute and file a claim. And the law on prosecuting elements of the military can only take place when the Minister of Defense agrees to that, whatever the kind of crime be that is going to be prosecuted. The same applies for the customs forces and the police. it can only be take place and it can only be prosecuted when the minister in charge agrees to that. And that's how the president and the regime protects everyone that belongs to him. They can kill as much as they want from the people. They can commit as many crimes as they want to fortify their power. And that's why we as Syrians, this question of the immunity from, or the impunity and the immunity from punishment is something that is very dominant in our lives, that we've gotten used to as Syrians. I can not really file a claim against any member of the security forces, and only giving the right to prosecute a member of the security forces would be a great surprise for any Syrian. That would be a new thing for them. That's why the regime is so scared by this kind of claim now being filed in foreign jurisdictions, since impunity is, or the impossibility of going on with impunity is something that's going to sabotage its power, very power basis. And you can be sure that many criminals in the Syrian army or elsewhere would not have committed these crimes if they'd known that they're going to be held accountable, and we could have saved enormous amount of human lives. If the Syrian president Bashar al-Assad would not benefit from this immunity, a great number of crimes would not have been committed, and not that many people would have been killed and executed. We could have saved lots of lives of many Syrians. But unfortunately, this message has not been sent out. Since 2011, I have been asking for, in 2000, in Belgium, granted the possibility to its courts to open such cases. But then this possibility was again closed in 2002 for the victims. And we are still asking for opening up this possibility that international cases in international law can be looked into in front of European courts. And in Germany, we try to benefit from this possibility, and I think that's something great we have here in Germany. And we want to send out the message to the perpetrators and the criminals that the time of impunity that Syrians have experienced all their lives is now about to end or has already ended, and that now the time for standing up and for accountability has come. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. I think it has become very clear that justice is the most important precondition for a meaningful negotiation process. Thank you. One last word from Khaled.
Yeah. Thank you. Actually, I just want to add something very fast. A lot of countries today said, okay, we want to fight ISIS, and they are putting plans to fight ISIS, to fight al-Nusra, to fight all the other extremist organization. But what we are working on this project today is the real way to fighting ISIS. It's the real way to fighting al-Nusra. And thanks for Mr. Mazen Darwish to remind us about this really important point. And the second point, I just want to add it, it's really make me sad after all of the what happened in Syria in the last 6 or 7 years. A lot of... Actually, it's my daughter, so... Yeah. Okay. So... After 6 or 7 years of after what happened in Syria, in the news, a lot of politicians, they said, okay, it's civil war. It's not a civil war. It's a revolution. And a lot of people said also it's a conflict. It's not a conflict. It's a revolution. It's a real revolution. What all of the detainees, those detainees I've talked about, all of them was in 2011. There were no weapons in Syria. There were no weapons in Damascus, especially, or in all other cities. So it's not civil war. It's not conflict. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you.